Okay, good afternoon class. Now I will be sharing the screen. So we are seeing the conventional approach of digital design, right? Conventional approach for the digital design. We have already seen this. So in this process, we have seen just as an example, Qn Q suffix n plus 1 is equal to Qn plus A into B. There we are using AND OR input. Two ICs. One is AOI gate and other one is the flip flop. We require flip flop here to store the output value what we get from the AOI gate, right? Next, we have seen this. So, if you recall the previous class, what we are doing when a very big design is there, if you want to design a very big design, if you want to design a very big circuit, first we have to identify what are the major components. Later, we have to identify whether we have those components in hand or not. That means in the library or not. Or else, if you see here, first we have to decide the requirements at the system level and we have to translate them to the circuit requirements. And then we have to identify the major functional blocks required, such as timers and DMA, that is direct memory access units and register files. Say as in the designer of a processor, right? Whenever a function can be realized using a standard ICs, okay? A function can be realized using a standard IC, or if not, such as the standard ICs, generally we will be using the counter, mux and demux, etc. If it is not possible to design with the help of standard ICs, we have to design those circuits by our own. Okay. See here. So we have to go for the paper design. Then starting from the paper design, we have to go up to the circuit layout. If you have to design the circuit, if you have to design some particular circuit by your own, you have to go in that such a fashion. See here, this is the simple processor or process, a simple processor, a process flow chart. Here, first you are having system requirements, then you have circuit requirements. First, you should have the idea of what is the output you require. So for that output, to get that particular output, we should have some particular inputs. Then we have to identify the circuit requirements. Under the circuit requirements, we have to see what are the standard ICs required. Instead of designing everything, we will be using some amount of standard ICs in different combinations to get or to do some functionality. And we have to see some other components. As we said previously, different types of other components, such as resistors, transistors, or any other components. For an example, if you see any circuit, if you see a very big system, definitely there will be some ICs and there will be some discrete components. Okay. Very rarely we will be having only ICs. Okay, as the days has passed, now we are designing everything in a single IC only, almost all the components, all other components also now it is in the single IC only, right? So after that, identifying these, what are the ICs and what are the components, we have to have a paper design, and that paper, as per the paper design, we have to design a PCB layout.
Yeah. Right.
We have to design a PCB layout, and then we have to place the components, and we have to go for wiring on the printed circuit board and then we have to go for testing of that particular total printed circuit board with the components which is present there. Then we will be having the final circuit. So after getting the final circuit only, we can say whether the corresponding, that means what the output we are expecting is coming or not. Okay. Now you see here at the debugging stage, we may have different types of problems. One is functional mismatch, other one is timing mismatch, and other one is the overloading or overload. See the functional mismatch. Functional mismatch is nothing but we are expecting some amount of function, but after placing all the components and ICs and after connecting the components one to the other, the functionality may be different. Okay, we are taking some ICs, placing on the printed circuit board, and we are taking some discrete components, placing on the board, and we are wiring and testing, connecting, and all these things is done. But meanwhile, we can identify some amount of errors there, such as functional mismatch. We are expecting some functionality, and we are expecting some output. It is not giving that particular output. That particular IC or that particular system is not giving that particular output. Next, we may have some timing mismatches also. Okay. As I said, a single signal will be moving in different paths and reaching at some node, and it may be changing some, that means it is coming at different nodes. One signal will be coming faster, one signal will be coming very much slow, and it may cause to the mismatch, timing mismatch. Okay. It is mentioned clearly there in the timing mismatch. Next, overload. You can see the overload. Some signals may be overloaded in such an extent that signal transition may be delayed or even suppressed. Okay, sometimes it may be mismatching. That means sometimes it may the delay, if the delay is too heavy, or else that particular signal may be due to the overloading, it may be totally suppressed. Do you see that? As an example, if you see, if you want to transmit a signal from one place to the other, we will be using the repeaters, right? For an example, if you are taking some broadband connection, what they are doing, they will be placing one box in someone's house, and they will be giving some power supply to that box, and battery will be there inside it. Whenever the power is off, it takes some power from the plug, right? It is consuming some amount of power and maintaining the battery. And what is the work of that particular box? It is just like a repeater. It will be strengthening the signal. Do you get now? If it is not like that, due to the overload, we can't transmit a signal in a wire for longer distances. So meanwhile, we require some amount of repeaters to strengthen this signal once again. Okay. If you don't use the repeaters, the signal what we are having, audio video signal, will be suppressed and we won't get the proper output. Okay, audio video signal or any other signals will be suppressed due to the overloading, and we won't get the proper output there. So as I said, now this thing, generally we have to follow all these things if you are creating the analog circuits. So if I want some particular functionality, I have to do all these things, and at the end, if I may not get proper circuit also. Instead of doing all these things, what I can do is, let me verify in the initial stage itself whether I can get the particular functionality or not. Let me verify with the help of some tools. You already know that VLSI is considered as classified into two categories. One is digital side, another one is the analog side. Instead of doing all this work on the analog side, but first of all, let us do on the digital side itself. Instead of taking general discrete components, hardware components, and connecting them and all doing all these things, instead of that, why don't we go for designing a program for it, or with the help of an hardware description language, and verify it whether we can go for the circuit manufacturing or not, or fabrication. In the VLS language, we have to talk like this. We have to say it as fabricating of that particular IC. Okay. See, here we are mentioning there all this prototype PCB manufacturing, it involves cost and also time and also redesigning process to develop and debug bug-free design, right? Now just you'll see what VLS design is here. Okay, the complexity of VLS is very large. Integrated circuits being designed and used today makes the manual approach to design impractical. Why? So we, as we studied, we have small scale integration, medium scale integration, large scale integration. Later we are having VLS design, very large scale integration. Now ultra scale integration is also there. That means the number of transistors accumulated on a single silicon wafer die has increased drastically. Now it is in the order of 2.5 million in that range. We can't do those on manually. It can be done only through the help of machines only. Okay, design automation is the order of the day. Then you can decide, you can say that the design automation is the order of the day. Okay, we can't do manually, so automatically it has to be done with the help of some machines only. So see here, with the rapid technological development in a few decades, the status of VLSI technology is characterized by following. This thing we can say that there is a steady increase in the size and hence the functionality of the ICs. So in the day-to-day life, the consumers of different electronic gadgets are requiring different types of features. So automatically it can be done with the help of that leads to the count of increasing the count of number of transistors accumulated on the die. Okay, and this can also be possible only with the help of decrease in the feature size. What is the feature size? It is generally the distance between the source and the drain. That will be generally indicated with the help of 2 lambda. And in the VLS design, we have already studied 1.2 micron technology, okay, 2 micrometer technology, different orbit technologies and all. Do you get now? Those are the technologies which indicates the feature size. That means 2 lambda indicates the distance between the source and the drain. Due to the decrease in the size, automatically the speeds gets increased. And also the transistor density. Transistor density means that only. Number of transistors accumulated in silicon wafer die gets increased. Okay. And we will be having steady improvement in the predictability of circuit behavior. And also a steady increase in the variety and the size of software tools for the VLS design. In the initial days of VLSI, we used to have very less number of VLS design tools. Later on, in the last few decades, we have different types of tools with the different types of features which is helping a lot in manufacturing, or you can fabricate in the different varieties of ICs. Okay. So due to the improvement of all these things, it has increased the proliferation of approaches to PLS designs and procedures of automated design flow. Here, our aim always has led to the hardware description language implementation during the design process. Okay, an abstraction based model is given here. You see here, abstraction model. It is having different layers. So the total model divides the whole design cycle into various domains. See, from the bottom you go to the top. From the bottom you go to the top. See the geometric objects. First, silicon. We take general silicon. And we form transistors, that is capacitors, inductors, resistors. All these things will be under the circuits, that is called as differential equations. We are using the differential equations and this discrete type of components, transistors, LRCs, and we also use gates and flip-flops, where we use the Boolean equations. And at the register level, where you have truth tables or state tables, in structural domain it is mentioned with the help of registers, arithmetic logic units, multipliers and all. And other, you can see the chips, micro operations, which is used to perform micro operations. It is generally microprocessors or some memories or input output devices. And we also have at the system level. Okay, at the system level, we will be seeing the processing core, maybe non-digital or non-electronic systems. There, we have different domains. You can see the thick lines in between them, which we can say that one domain is not going to depend on the other. Okay, the thick lines indicates that one domain is not going to depend on the other one. So you have seen this abstraction. You have different layers. A designer have one layer can function without bothering another layer above or below. That is indicated with the thick horizontal lines separating these layers. In the figure you can see there, significantly the compartmentalization. So for an example, you see a design at the gate level, circuit to be designed would be described in terms of truth tables and state tables. With these as available inputs, he has to express them as a Boolean logic equations and relays them in terms of gates and flip-flops. That means what we want to say here is one domain is not going to depend on the other domain. Everything can be done parallelly. Later on it can be clubbed and mixed up to get the required functionality. So compartmentalization of the approach to design in the manner described here is the essence of abstraction. It is the basis for the development and use of a CAD tool in VLS design at various levels, right? We have different CAD tools, computer aided design tools, for VLSI also at different levels we have different level, different types of tools. Okay, so for Boolean equations, for truth tables, state transition tables, etc., so generally we will be choosing a tool which will be performing all the domains for the better designs generally. So if you see here ASIC design flow, once you can see here the ASIC design flow once. So generally we have major activities, and also we can see the in keen, we can observe in detail in the next figure also regarding the ASIC. What is ASIC then? ASIC is application specific integrated circuit. Application specific integrated circuit. Why we are studying this? Now, as I said previously, when we want to design a very large system, first task of us is to identify what are the circuit components required. First and foremost, we will be identifying the system requirements. That means what are the outputs, what is the output we have to get, for that what are the inputs we have to use, and then we have to go for the circuit components. Under the circuit components, what we are seeing, we are seeing different types of ICs and some components. Now in the IC we have some standard ICs that can perform, that particular IC can perform the task or else by using that standard ICs in different combinations, by connecting those in different combinations we can get some functionality. If we don't have in such a manner, what we have to do? We have to go for designing our own IC from the scratch level onwards. Okay, from the scratch level we have to design our own IC. But our own IC is nothing but application specific integrated circuits. We can say simply, for an example, if you take a remote operated car where its functionality is to move forward and backward, take left turn and right turn and reverse. How many functionalities I have said? One is moving forward, other one is moving backward, other one is to take left turn, other one is to take right turn. Almost only four functionalities. For that only four functionalities, I can't use a very big microprocessor or a microcontroller. I require very less amount of memory for my application. Instead of using a very standard IC, either a microprocessor or microcontroller, it may cost, if I use a very big microprocessor or microcontroller, it costs more for me. So what I have to do is, I have to go for designing my own IC with some little bit amount of memory, little bit amount of microcontroller. That means it has to perform some actions, storing some little bit amount of memory, like this it is required for me. For that I am designing the ICs. The ICs cost will be coming very much less. There will not be any wastage of memory or anything. But the task here is, it is a little bit complex to design our own IC, but we can use that particular ASIC to perform our own operation. Do you get now? Okay. So generally you can see development of ASIC starts with an idea and takes tangible shape through the stages of development that you can see in the figure, and that can be detailedly seen in the figure B. Okay, that which is in the next slide. Here we are having the first slide. You can see here generally we should have the idea. Okay, and next we have design description. First we will have an idea, then we have to describe the design, then we have to go for simulation. What is this simulation? Simulation is nothing but we are verifying the functionality. We are verifying the functionality whether the required output we are getting or not. We are verifying the functionality. Later what you see here in the simulation, there a dotted line is there once again going to the above the design description. What does it mean? First we have an idea, then we go for design description, then we go for the simulation. In the simulation, if you get the proper functionality, it is okay, well and good, we stop there. If you don't get proper simulation result, that means the functionality result, we have to go once again back and we have to change the design. Until we get the correct functionality, we have to do this process. Once the simulation is done properly, that means the functionality is achieved, we can go for synthesis. Where in the synthesis, what you will be identifying here is, you will be identifying for the given description what you have used components. It will be showing what are the components you have used. You will be having some netlist, and it will be showing how you are connected. That means one component is connected to the other. How one component is connected to the other. And then we'll be going for the physical design. If you have a design, if it is synthesizable only, we can go for the physical design process. Okay. Once you get the components netlist, then only we'll be going for the physical design process. Okay. We'll continue in the next class. Okay, next class we'll see in detail what the all ASIC design and development flow is. Okay, that's all for today.